Okay, this begins the August 17th meeting of the Financial Advisory Committee. We started a little late at 4:07. We were trying to give a little time for more people to show up, including our district representative, Ms. Gittens. At this time, we're going to start the meeting. We have three in attendance. We have John Shannon, Mark
Nowitzki,
and myself, Daryl Tebow. I'm talking here.
No, that won't work. That gets this one.
Oh, okay.
So there's an Ada comment online. We do not have a quorum, but we're still going to hold the meeting and just not vote today. Let's proceed since we don't have anybody from the public here.
Oh, can I talk for the public for a minute?
Sure, you can make a statement.
You know, I try not to make this sound bad, but every so once in a while, people don't believe things that come out of the school district. So when the Three Oaks Elementary got killed because the planning staff said you don't have the need for it, well, the latest subdivision that's coming in Estero, the planning district of the, or the planning of the school district said we don't have the capacity for it. So if you told us, you know, a year ago that we got plenty of capacity, we don't need a new school, and now you're telling me 9 months later that we don't have the capacity. That's why the school district gets a reputation that we don't believe anything you say. I'm not saying trying to be bad or derogatory or anything else. This is the kind of stuff. So I look at every new development coming out because somebody in your planning division, and it's, I don't know who's running it today, but signs off, do we have enough seats? And it's just at the elementary level, there's not enough seats for this. And it's only 56 units. You know, it's not even a 500, it's 56 units, and that's just what it is. So, thanks.
Thank you. I will check with them on that.
Yeah, because I'm a believer that though before the planning staff signs off saying we have the capacity, I believe the board ought to get a memo saying, you know, this is what's going on. We looked at this property and we looked at how many people it's supposed to be. In Estero, if the numbers are 0.2 of every house is an elementary and 0.3 is a middle and 0.1 is a high schooler, Estero's way below that because we're a bunch of, some of us are older. We can't say old farts anymore.
I read that bubble over your head.
Yeah. Gwen and I go way back. But anyway, you know, so this is just one of those things that if the planning staff comes online, again, it says that. I think the school board ought to know that because somebody's going to go up to the school board, you know, members and say, hey, were you fibbing to me then or you fibbing to me now? You know, so just I think I owe that to share that with you.
Just so I have the right information. A community went to Estero to ask for, to be able to put the community in.
Correct.
Somebody from our planning department told the Estero community, planning community, that there was not enough seats, elementary seats.
Correct. So what happens when a community goes before either Lee County or Fort Myers or anybody, they got to go to the fire department, the police, the water and sewer, blah, blah, and they got to get to the school. So somebody on the planning staff says, we don't have the capacity. And if I remember, I'll send you the name of the community so you can look at that. So everyone that comes online, consequently, the other thing too is there's a new 10,000 homes going out kind of at 82 in Cork Street. 10,000 homes, okay? And so in my mind, it's time for the planning staff to go in and say, hey, we need 65 acres to build a school on your 10,000 homes. And it's kind of between the east and the south zone where it is. You know, just like they gave 5 acres to the fire department, the previous community, so they can build a fire station. As a homeowner, I would love to have a school in my community that the kids could walk to, and to me, that's a win-win. So that's...
And I'll just make one comment on that. I agree with you on developers, you know, offering us some land to do schools if if it's warranted. The problem with, for example, that 10,000 homes, the student generation rate is way, way low. And so I think it was like 200 or something. And that's what they look at. So if the student generation rate was, you know, 7, 8, you know, 1,000 kids or something, that then we could bargain with them on giving us some space for these kids that are coming in. But that of the student generation rate is kind of the deal breaker for some of them.
And how did they decide that? Because of the value of the homes?
No, they took, there's a formula that
I understand, if, and I know the formula, and the formula would have generated, you know, probably 1,000 students or more.
Well, it's, the formula takes in, you know, who the age and everything of the people moving in. And
well, how do they know? They haven't even turned the shovel yet.
I don't know the formula.
Yeah, and their big thing is they can't overbuild. If you overbuild, it's a problem too. And I know it, you're what, 7 years out if you decide you're going to build the between the plans and the land, and then the city, then the county, then the state approving it, because the state has to approve it too. Nowadays,
well, and that's
it's like, I think it was 7 years.
Right now with schools is that puts us behind.
Always, you're always going to be behind.
But we are more behind, in some places than others, because it takes so long.
You know, it's funny though, when the school board just a month ago approved that new charter school that's going to be right out in the same area.
They don't own the charter school.
I understand that, but they still had to approve it.
But we can't tell them no. We didn't have.
You can, but it gets challenged. It looks bad.
Okay. Challenges to tell them they couldn't build it.
Yeah. It looks real bad.
I understand that, but that goes to my point that I think there's enough kids out there. I don't believe the estimate that there's only 200 kids. In 10,000 homes. Yeah. That's why I love Deves. Yeah. And they didn't do it this year.
Well, Deves Demographics has that
If they did, they wouldn't give it to me in Freedom of Information.
Deves isn't required to the district.
Yeah.
They're not a public entity.
They did that for proximity originally. I don't think they've done it since that original proximity.
There's three or four communities out there that are going to be like Bella Terra that are going to be the biggest communities with kids. And I think this 10,000, because of the location of this, because you're going to go out to 82 one way, Corkscrew the other way, you're going to be close to the casino in Immokalee, everything else. I think it's going to be more than 200.
Real quick, what is our total amount on this committee? How many people are left? We're at 5 now.
And we did receive packets of applications yesterday.
She said they're pretty slim.
Yeah. I don't know what you guys said. We need food.
I guess I'm coming back next week.
Which
family? Mr. Shannon's going to be putting his application in again because they could not locate it, so he's going to do it again. So.
Awesome. And who else? Are you coming back?
I'm good for another year.
He's good for another year. We have 7 that are good for another year.
What's a quorum?
Because we're really still working off of the previous one.
We need 15.
Yeah.
15 is the total. That's 2.
I also submitted an application.
There you go.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Shelby.
Because there's 2 per board member, and then the chair has an additional.
Yep.
So there should be 15.
Yep.
So a quorum would be 7, 8.
For a 5. Okay. Guess what? It's a chairperson report.
Yeah.
I was trying to get quorum in there. I really was.
Oh, boy.
I got all my questions lined up already.
Okay.
Same ones.
Well, I'll keep my part short. basically, we had a briefing meeting yesterday, and if you did not have the opportunity to watch that one, I highly recommend that you do for a couple of reasons. there is a lot of misconception that we have more power than God and Jesus Christ all rolled up into one, and we keep telling people we don't.
You didn't fix homeowners insurance yet?
Oh, man, you know.
Being lazy.
And the potholes.
Yes.
We're just behind. What can I say? We can take that time. But in actuality, people believe that every issue, it's like, okay, we can just vote on it and we fix it. And the explanation yesterday about curriculum was excellent in that it said the curriculum comes from Tallahassee, from DOE. And our job, it's like any laws or statutes, our job is to say, how are you going to institute that? And we are watched closely by our friends in Tallahassee that if we do not do that correctly, then we can be called upon and called on the carpet. So people have to understand that some of the things they're saying that, you know, the board is doing, we don't have that power. And if we step outside of that, report us. I'm begging you.
Wouldn't be the first or the last time.
Yeah, I know that's right.
Gwen, you know, Gwen, that's interesting too, because I think I look at the, you know, the teachers and all the aides, everybody, the adds and subtracts, people retirement. And there's like four or five lawyers on staff, you know, at least. And it's like probably what half of the lawyers are doing is trying to figure out what to do with what Tallahassee told us to do.
Mm-hmm. But see, that is, and honestly, that's very true.
Yeah.
Because every time something comes down, and Kelly can affirm to this, that says thou shalt, you know,
right,
do this, then we have to say we are going to do it, and here's how and when and who will do it. And that's, you know, in my current situation, people have asked me at least twice a day, what is the role of a school board member? It's to follow the law. That's our main, that's it.
Mm.
And everything else, you know, peripheral with that. So when it comes to even like, you know, the property and all that you're talking about, there are a whole lot of players involved.
Oh, yeah, it's not a two-minute
decision. And it's not
decision.
Something that we decide, whatever, you know, we're going to do this, and there it goes. So I just want to make that clear, and yesterday's meeting, briefing meetings, were very good explaining, staff was up there and explaining exactly how the curriculum is developed, where it comes from, and, the opening of school was going swimmingly, and still, you can take that however you want.
Yeah,
she
right?
said I'm
convincingly.
Yeah. No, it really is. I was at it, I went to seven schools on the first day, and if...
What's your biggest complaint that you've heard? Because all I hear is transportation. I hear the teachers are great, there's some new ones coming in. In fact, my daughter got a new teacher today.
Yeah.
But the only thing I hear is people complaining
about transportation.
If that's the worst we have, it's
and
it could be worse. No kids have been lost yet. I haven't heard of any.
No. And actually, an example we talked about yesterday, we get an update every day at the end of the day as to when all the buses are in and all of the places. The superintendent shoots us a time. You know, this, all the buses are here and here and here. And one day we were off by, you know, 20 minutes or so with one group of buses, but it was because the parent was not there when they were dropping the one child off, and they waited. So that put us behind. To me, that's a wonderful 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Because it says, no, we're not, okay, go, Johnny.
Yeah.
She'll be home one day. You know?
Good luck.
You'll see him. Yeah, good luck. Otherwise, I'll pick you up.
Wait at the bus stop right here. See you tomorrow.
So it's that kind of issues. I got a lot of complaints traffic-wise from residents that don't have children that were trying to get places and could not. So And, you know, we explained it's the growing pains, and like the superintendent said, the first couple of days, if you turned on your TV and you were a parent, all you heard was, yeah, we don't have enough bus drivers, and you have the ability to drive your child, what are you going to do? Drive your child. So for the first couple of days, everybody that could did. So the roads were great.
Most, a lot of times, even parents that don't do it throughout the year will do it the first couple of days anyway.
Yeah.
So you're always going to have to do that first couple of days.
And kindergartners and all that, you know, you're not going to put them on the bus the first day. So that was the traffic issues in the very beginning. We're kind of working those out. And I think as parents trust us more in getting them home safely, it's like you send your child, I'll see if it works. Next week I'll try and run. But I think we're working through a lot of stuff. You mentioned teachers. You're aware that we had the program with the foreign like exchange teachers that were coming over. And part of the issue was some of them didn't get here before school started, and they're gradually coming in, you know, at way through leases and stuff like that. So, but we're getting there, and if you do have children in school, or know someone who does, all I can tell you is every chance you get, thank a teacher, thank an administrator, tell them, you know, I know it's rough right now, but we got you, and we know it's going to get better. Because the last thing we want is for them to feel unnecessary and unneeded and they decide to go to. So there's a lot of different initiatives out there about how to deal with the teacher shortage. We talked yesterday about a legislative piece that I had put on back in 2019, I think, where, and you ask what I hear in the schools, I've heard a lot of administrators and even teachers say that people that had worked as teachers and couldn't pass the test by like 1 or 2 points. It's not like they were way down and got D's and F's. So the legislative agenda piece asked for professional points for teachers that show that they, you know, are highly qualified. And that, if we could ever get that through, will save a lot of teachers.
Well, it might bring back a few, too.
It'll probably bring back some. And when you think every time they don't pass that and they take it again, it's $200 or more out of their
pocket. Yeah, I know that person.
Yeah. Yeah, trust me, I've spent a couple of years.
I found that to be very angering, if nothing else.
And it's very frustrating. So anyway, that's something, we have a new legislative
liaison
that's been hired, and that will be coming on the scene really soon.
Was that from the June 14th meeting?
I think so.
You gave me notes from our last meeting that I'm reading, because I put 3 questions there, and that's number
that
3, legislative priorities, June 14th meeting. To ask you about is the first question today.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't, that the legislative, I think the June 14th was when the board was talking about their legislative priorities. I think the consultant or the new liaisons were approved in July sometime.
Right, mid-July.
Yeah.
Because it was whatever. So we were getting
new. You're talking about lobbyists.
Yes.
Paid lobbyists. So
yeah.
Believe it or not, I went in and said, okay, school district, freedom of information. Give me their performance metrics for the lobbyists. And the answer came back and said, we don't have them. Or they won't give them to me.
We should. I mean, considering we're hiring, that we just hired someone, they had to be vetted.
I understand, but I'm just telling you what I got. I got nothing.
Okay.
All I got was the statement of work. Nothing, you know. And I'm not saying that you're going to get so many dollars, but there should be something in there that they have so many meetings with congressmen, you know, or area, you know, so many meetings. Yeah, something, you know, they're giving you an info sheet once a week who they talk to. There should be some kind of metrics there.
And usually they do. Even with the previous one,
okay,
we got a weekly update. like sometimes too.
And that's good. So yeah. So if there's some area that you see that they're not working on, then you can, you know, as the board, and I think the answer kind of came back as they're hired by the board on your damn business. So
basically, yeah, that's probably what I would expect. I wouldn't take that personally. That's exactly what I would expect. You asked me about, we spoke about three things at the last meeting.
Okay.
First was legislative priorities, June 14th meeting. Second was, have the legislative priorities changed? And I told you I was going to ask you again, what is the FP money per student allocation coming up for this school year? And the reason I was asking that, I'm trying to figure out, was there enough ground made from the state legislature that we can feel comfortable to say that hopefully there's going to be reasonable union negotiations on both sides? I know that doesn't, it's not coming across the way I want it to, but.
That is the biggest pothole that I'm not even going to tell you.
But I was wondering, are we in the positive or are we struggling to break even again?
Okay, this is.
Which Kelly might probably know the answer.
I know that normally it has to do with the count. I mean, once they set it.
Yeah.
At the federal level, they came back and said school districts $15 an hour, and the superintendent by October 1st has to send a letter saying that every one of our employees are making a minimum of $15. So we have to deal with getting all of those people that weren't there up to there. So along with the money came a large amount of expenses as well, and so that's something that we'll be going over with the board on September 7th. Going through that.
That's a good question then.
Yeah, so we're still working on it, but there were things that come with it. And then, of course, one of the other things we have to look at is when you bring all of those low people up to 15, right, and you've had other people whose their job beginning was 15,
pissed
now
off.
You've got them here. So we have compression issues, and can we afford to deal with compression issues? And all of those things have to be looked at as we're looking through.
And then those people leave, and then we hire people. That have to be $15 now.
Yeah.
I forget the word for it. They give us money and then they.
Unfunded mandates along with it.
Yes.
I have a statement because I know if I ask it as a question, you can't answer it. I have a statement for you then.
Okay.
I'm basically going to say if you created an account that said anything on social media, and you followed what's going on with the school district on the employee's website, there's two things that they talk about, the wages and the benefits. You should read what they put on the benefits on there. I think you would find that very interesting in your position as someone that worked for the district, someone that's a board member for the district, and someone that's running for office. I think you would find that very interesting, eye-opening. I also think anyone in the room or online that did the same thing would understand why most of my questions come about, because I'm trying to help. I'm really trying to help everyone. That's literally been my only goal the last 7-8 years I've been on this committee. But that's why I always bring up benefits every single year.
And I will tell you.
Some of the stories.
Offer all.
That's why I said it the way I tried to say it the way I did without saying a fake name.
People send me screenshots, but I don't dip my toe in the water, and I just wait for people to.
Some of the stories are appalling that I can't get this done, I can't get that done. Medically necessity. Yeah. I'm forced off of the job and some of the stuff just blows my mind.
Well, and to me personally, I'm not speaking for the board, but. You know, when COVID hit, build your staff up and pay them like that, and you can't change their salary structure like that. It just doesn't happen. But the economy was not waiting for us to catch up to be able to give people what they may need. So anyway, that's my Gwynnism. Any other questions?
That was it. I wanted to find out. I figure with the legislative priorities at this point, that's probably going to be held off until the next committee in September, because you're bringing on somebody new at this point.
We
so it's probably going to change a little.
I kind of heard, well, we're each going to be meeting with the new person individually. We need to talk about whatever we want to. And then, so if you have questions for me when it's my turn, if you want to shoot me an email or whatever, I'll make sure to ask it.
Take away the power from the state to choose the curriculum. I'm good.
You're naive.
No.
Yes.
No, I look at it as I'm starting to look at some of these homeschoolers, and I'm going, well, as long as they pass the test that the state's going, but those tests are really becoming the problem for a lot of students. I know. And trying to put all these new curriculums and force the schools into them is becoming more even crazier. I was listening to a political debate all that, and I'm like, you're both wrong. You both
right.
got, you, but neither one of you really understand.
Right.
Go talk to any parent, you know?
If you, I'm saying, I went to all these different schools at the beginning of the school year. The most fascinating was FSW High School, Collegiate High School. And people have in their mind that it's just all the brainiac kids and so, and all of this. It was fascinating what they're doing. And they are allowing kids to think outside the box. They are allowing them to learn to work together. I mean, the first day, each class had a problem they had to solve, and they had to be in groups to solve it. And I will never forget, at the end of the, they had like 30 seconds or a minute left, and Principal Box said, okay, everybody stop. Got about a minute left. He says, I know that's a lot of pressure on you, but that's what life is all about. And now, not only the pressure, but you have to share that pressure amongst the group to come up with an answer with only 1 minute left. And just the daily type stuff they were doing was just fascinating. And I just would like to see more of that type of, you know, teaching and training. But as long as we have a test and a, you know, prepare for the test and you know, we're going to get what we set out to do.
Thank God I got a senior.
That was the sad part of junior achievement.
Yeah.
They did a lot of good things, but it took away from the prep for the test.
Yeah.
You know, and then you had to kind of, you know, try and find some time to sneak it in. And not mess up what they're trying to
well,
do.
Well, I have just doing that 6 days.
I'm sorry?
Junior treatment was during the day.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh.
That can happen. Well, for the next 6 days, I can't even touch that question.
Okay.
Think about what I'm saying.
All right.
Okay, let's move on.
Okay, what else?
We've put Gwen on the stage for too long.
No, that's okay. Anybody else have any? Does anybody there have any questions for me?
Anybody online have questions?
We're at seven.
Nope, I'm here. Great seeing everybody.
Good seeing you, Kyle.
Yeah.
Okay.
The seven make one?
Thank you.
Eight.
Damn it. We're so close. One away. I thought we might pull it off.
I know. I was counting after. I'm like, wait a minute. More people are checking
did,
out.
Didn't we lose one or two? I thought we lost one or two.
One, two. That's okay. I think we
were from our roster, I'm pretty sure we had lost one or two.
I was driving. But I couldn't do it, so I finally came here to my office. So,
good
evening,
sorry. So, Kelly, we're probably looking until November to get the budget book then for this year?
The budget book will be done for the board meeting in September electronically. It will be ready electronically by then. The physical book will probably be September, you know, weeks into September or October before you have a physical room. Yes.
So my question I asked about a month ago was all the supplemental pays that for coaches and, you know, prom sponsor and all that kind of stuff, what was in the contract, was that a monthly rate or a quarterly rate or a biweekly or an annual?
What's in the contract is, that depends on the supplements. When you talk sports, it's for that sports
time frame, right?
But the other supplements would be, like, if it's a great chair, that would be an annual supplement.
Okay.
They get it throughout their paycheck.
So if they're the yearbook sponsor, whatever,
It's been a full year.
Okay, it's per paycheck per year.
The amount is per year, and it's divided up into paychecks. So the amount is a yearly amount.
And so we've got to eat that out of the fee we get per student, then, basically.
Yes, that is correct.
All right.
Okay, let's move on to Tracy.
So this is Tracy. She is our Director of Procurement Services, and she has brought Lori Nye, who is the coordinator for procurement services, with her. And so Tracy, I'll let her go, but basically she didn't come prepared with anything because it was really kind of like, what is it that you want to know, and she will answer your questions.
Right. That was the easier way to go.
I'm assuming
each one of us has a few questions. My only question was about with the prices of goods going up, how are you dealing with them?
Okay.
That's probably the elephant in the room is how do we deal with things when Kelly's budgeted for a new AC system at $120,000 and they quote you $450,000?
Right. That is happening.
I know.
So the way that we're handling that, we do have in our published solicitations a clause that says that upon approval, if they submit the required information, which they have to basically prove that they are having to pay more, that we would take a look at that, and if we agree, we would allow that. I will tell you that it's about half and half right now as to what we're approving and as to what we're declining. If we feel like it's a significant increase, some of it would be like services and things, we have declined some of those, and that would be more like on the maintenance end. But when we look at these, you know, I'm looking at one right now that we received this week about paper towels for our warehouse. So we stock paper towels in the warehouse, and the vendor has come back and asked for a price increase. They have submitted all the information from their suppliers, and we have taken a look at this, and of course the warehouse manager agrees, and we have allowed that. So it's a case-by-case basis. We also have talked to a lot of our other school districts. They're also experiencing the same similar types of requests. They're handling them the same way that we are, so we're collaborating with them just to see, what are you doing, you know, and bouncing different ideas off of how that works.
Can I ask on that, so when they came to you with the higher price, do you go back out for bid?
We can. So that's another thing, I'm glad that you mentioned it. So right now, let's just say we have a multi-award, a primary, secondary, tertiary, I'm saying that right, and let's just say that the vendor is asking for a price increase right now, they're first place. That could change the ranking order. So that first place vendor could then become third place. So we let them know that, and we have changed several of them. Well, maybe not several, a couple of them that would have been like that. So, you know, it's one thing they think they're going to get a price increase, but then they lose that work that they potentially could have. And a lot of the price increases are, you know, justifiable. I mean, I could stand up and justify them. Some are not, and we have not allowed it. So they can either stick with their pricing that they originally submitted, or we can remove them from that solicitation. Now, if they were the only one, yes, we would have to go out for a new bid. Or look for a feedback option.
So it's basically a gamble for them.
The piggybacking seems to work pretty well because all the board meeting minutes almost somebody else that's got a good contract
yes.
or whatever.
Right.
So.
And believe it or not, we have a lot of school districts that do that off of our midstream.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does everybody understand what we're
mm-hmm.
talking about? Okay.
Yes.
Just checking.
Piggyback saved not only us a lot of work, but they saved a lot of other districts and entities.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So, and if they were, if the vendors are willing, and we always reach out to the vendors if they are okay with us piggybacking and can service our area, if it's had a service agreement. So it works out for everybody all the way around.
Okay, can I ask
Mendel?
It's the three of us in one line.
Well,
I thought a conversation was the best way to go. I hope you don't mind. I just thought this was probably the best way.
I think this is awesome. Yes, this is great.
It won't take as long, but at the same time, you know,
yes.
sometimes we can come up with an idea. Offer that. We do great. If we don't, that's fine.
Tell me to shut up.
Yeah,
and if I don't know
we'll
the answer,
her.
I'm going to tell you I don't
yeah.
know the answer, but
yeah.
I'll get you an answer.
So looking at the budget book that Kelly and her team puts out and everybody approves and everything, there's to me the difference in contracting between contracting for bodies and contracting for materials and supplies.
Correct, and they are separate.
Okay, so I turned in a Freedom of Information request and said, okay, how many contractors does the district have for bodies? And the answer came back, we don't know.
Who did you ask that question to?
The Freedom of Information Act people.
What was your question?
How many contractors? So we know we have so many principals. We have so many assistant principals. We have so many teachers. We have so many bus drivers. We have so many everybody else. So just give me a number of how many contractors you have. Contracted positions.
Contracted positions.
Yeah, so
yeah,
like,
that's an HR question.
That's a different question.
It's actually, yeah, it is a different question.
Yes,
the way
what you
depends
ask.
How you ask the question.
Okay.
So when you
yes.
ask contracted positions.
Right.
We don't budget in positions the contractors. It's a contracted service. So let's use our SLPs as an example. So we have some SLPs on staff.
SLPs are
speech language.
Okay,
languages.
Right, absolutely.
Sorry.
Yes.
And then there's some we don't have enough. So
correct.
We have to go get some. So it could be that we have a contract with ABC Company.
Sure.
And for the month of May, they may provide 3 SLPs to
okay.
fill in at this school, but then April, they may have only done 2.
Okay.
And March, they may have done 6. So
okay.
it's not like we have positions that we put these people
okay.
in. It fluctuates depending on who we can hire and who we cannot
okay.
hire.
So
your question, and I did see that come in,
what really confused me is I said, I don't know what FTE means.
Because
full-time equivalent. Are you kidding me?
because that's
business 101.
Yeah, that's not the way they hire.
I understand.
That's I think where the confusion was. And I actually was going back and forth with academic services because they kept sending it to me, and I'm like, I can only tell you how much your maximum amount
right.
of your
okay.
contract amount is. I can't tell you how many people you hired in that. That's the question that's being asked. How many people have you hired
right.
for that? So that's why they were really.
Confused.
They were having a hard time answering it because it's not
okay.
consistent. Now, what I can tell you is we have the contract now with the, you just said it, and I can't get it, the other countries,
right.
we contract
yes.
with
sure.
those
companies,
yes, and we have those positions.
Okay.
But we've hired them as our teachers, we're paying them as our
okay.
teachers and stuff like that. So. That's why the confusion, and I didn't know it was you who sent it. I just got it. And
sure.
The
reason is the idea then is in my experience, we did cost-benefit analysis. Is it easier, is it better to have contractors or have real government employees, in this case, school district employees? And if you don't know how many you got, it's kind of tough to say, you know, and especially with this $15 an hour thing, that might have been in it. So I was just trying to get a baseline. And to me, I think if somewhere buried in that budget book, too, it should be a total contracted out dollar. The idea of how much money the district puts into the economy, you know, for every person in the district, it creates three supplemental jobs: housing, food, autos, insurance, the whole bit. And I think
you're talking total wages or total impact of an economy.
Impact of an economy, and that's
you're asking even like. I'm going to throw something like a Super Bowl. Super Bowl comes to town.
Correct.
What is the impact on the economy?
Well,
I don't think a district can give me that type of dollar because they don't.
Well, but again, the idea that we're not just taking money and throwing it away. We are an integral. You're what, number two employer in a county, right? I think it's only either Lee Health or the county.
I think Lee Health is the only one I heard that's about.
That's bigger than you. So the amount of money, and the reason I say that, every Air Force base had to do this every year. How many, so for every person that was on the base, it created 2.2 jobs. And so as we're trying to look better to the citizens, some of this stuff might be better. So, yeah.
So we
I ask a lot of questions.
I appreciate it too. So we pay for our outside services as consultants if they're certified. So they have to be certified and hold the degree in the area.
Sure.
There's some things, and that's a certain object code that they're reported under. So
okay.
That's how you would find it with that object code. It's not always just FTE. There could be, you know.
Sure.
Another example is if we have trouble with our software, and we have to have a consultant come in to help us with the software.
Right.
They're in there. They're
right.
Only here for a short amount of time. It's not an FTE.
Yeah. Okay.
So, and that's why it's a hard answer.
Yeah. You never. Yeah. You've never really
service. Person.
Yeah.
Yes.
And another example was substitutes. I know at one point there was work being done to decide should we outsource.
Correct.
The substitutes. Should we outsource the buses? Should we outsource maintenance? So I know at some point they did some of that work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we do look at that. And like busing, there's no other bus services large enough to take on.
Correct.
The so it was like nobody could do it. There's
nobody
else out
there. No point even going out for a bid because you're not going to get anybody back.
Yes. And I think right now we're looking at piggyback bids for guest teachers. Say it another way. So,
you better because you know he'll be out.
I don't want anybody to come hard because I use that word. We're constantly looking at those things to see, you know, what's the best thing for our buck, which is the, you know, the best way to go so that we have the money we need for the classrooms and the people that we need to make sure that we have the services that have to be provided to our kids and stuff.
All right, so if we have a central warehouse of materials and supplies, is that what the courier does then, run them around to each of the school? Because
yes.
I struggle with still the need for a courier.
So we have...
somebody got to bring it there.
Well,
so they do, yeah,
is deliver.
We have couriers that deliver
yes.
food that's in our central warehouse. We have couriers who deliver mail to
okay.
our schools. We have couriers that deliver supplies to our schools and things that come in through the mailroom and stuff. So they do go out. We do have a central warehouse for certain items. We don't stock a lot, and we've gone through the warehouse and said, okay, so what items can the schools get directly that
right.
we don't have to pay someone to deliver? What we keep in our stock room are things that we can get at a better discount by in bulk
right.
and still pay that courier and
correct.
Still
okay.
do the best for the district.
Okay.
So we're constantly looking at that.
Okay.
We order by semi.
Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
If we increased it, went in with other school districts, like on the food and different things, would there be any more of a savings than we're already getting, or are we ordering top of the food chain? Top of that? You don't
have
to. I'll take that one for
go with Collier, Charlotte,
so
I mean on anything.
We are on a consortium with Collier, Charlotte, and someone else for our bread products,
yeah.
right? There's only one person left in Florida that can actually bake us the bread and deliver it. Because we all went in and gave them a total and said, hey, this is what we're going to use minimum. We got a better discount. The same thing with our fuel purchases. Collier Board of County Commissioners did a huge consortium, and Kurt brought in all of us for that, and we're on that one also. We take it to the board as a piggyback because we're not the lead on it, but we are actually part of that bid, and once again, because of the gallons that we are buying of diesel and all of that, we got a better deal because we're getting the Tampa rate instead of the Miami rate, even though it hasn't come farther. So we do all of that all the way around.
Well, the question with that, though, is you're getting the temporary, let's say it's a Tampa company, then there's still that distance to travel.
Actually, we have Palmdale, and Palmdale, there's actually a little local office right here on Fowler Street, and he has people, like, everywhere. So, and he can pick it up from Miami, and if he has to get it from Miami, we still get the better rate. Right. So it doesn't matter what the rate is that day at that location. It's the location where we actually have to bid from in the very beginning. So.
All right, so do you store fuel at each of the schools? Is there a generator?
Yeah, yeah, at the schools. We have compounds.
Not in schools, but
at
the bus
compounds. We have bus compounds that we have fuel. There are generators that back them up, so if a storm comes through, we can still pump them. We also supply fuel for all of the emergency vehicles, and we charge them, and I think there's a 5% upcharge for the
Something in the board meeting minutes, though, this time, there was something about a fuel farm or something at Estero High School.
Well, there's a compound out at Estero, so that's it's where there's some compounds that may be housed at near behind schools and stuff,
okay.
And that's where they are.
Because we have SREF if we had.
Well, I'm
just saying there would be restrictions.
You probably saw the Estero compound.
Yes, yeah, it's the Estero compound.
Yeah.
So is that the only one we have?
No, mm-hmm. We have.
There's 6 Mile, Estero,
there's five major islands.
Yeah, I'm trying to
remember. We've got big fuel islands.
Oh, okay. So when the buses need fuel, rather than coming all the way back here?
Oh, no. Where they're housed at is where they fuel up.
Okay.
Yeah. So if they're housed in the wet at the Cape, they're fueled there.
Okay.
If they're at 6 Mile, they're fueled there.
Okay.
Buckingham and Lehigh have to share one fuel, so yeah.
Okay.
Do you guys get the discount? They were talking state legislature about a tax holiday, October. It's kind of funny, the gas prices just fell under that number as we're heading towards that time frame, but would you guys get the discounts on that in the event that we leave into October with the average sale price of gas?
We don't pay taxes.
So there's no tax. You just get
we
the flat
pay,
rate.
We don't pay taxes, so yeah. Right. The school district is exempt from sales tax and stuff. Now they may do, I don't know what's in the bid for any kind of other tax, but I don't know. Like I know gas has multiple taxes.
Yeah, the city, the county, the state.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure what's in the bid, but the holiday was specifically, I believe, sales tax.
It was on gasoline for October. If the average price is $4 a gallon, the state's going to relinquish 25 or 50 cents of their end. Yeah, I don't even.
It's at the retail level.
Yeah.
It's not at the bulk fuel.
Okay.
Well,
and then you're already paying below that.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm
saying. You do like futures. You're buying it 6 months at a time or whatever.
The fuel?
Yeah.
We get fuel shipments basically every day, every other day at each location. Because we do go through that much fuel.
Wow. But don't you have like a contract that for the next 6 months this is the price, or do you pay?
It's a year at a time.
A year, okay. So you've locked in a rate for that year, whatever it is.
If the price drops, do you renegotiate, or are you able?
It's never going to drop lower than what we pay.
Okay.
Because we don't pay what everyone sees outside of in the
right.
In the real world,
yes.
We don't pay that. So it's never going to drop lower than what we pay. I don't think that's possible.
Okay. Well, that's why I'm asking. We're asking the question.
Yeah. I really don't think it's possible to go lower than what we pay because we are buying in such bulk and we are buying so much at a time that they are delivering to us.
With it being tax exempt and everything, it's probably really cheap compared
so
to what was a regular.
Because it's us, it's Leitrim, it's Charlotte, it's Collier, not only the districts, but the actual local entities. You know, it's actually the cities, the counties, and all that. So, yeah, it's quite a few. So, it's worth their while to deliver to all of us. And we did have, when COVID first started, we did have a couple of delivery issues. Luckily, we keep enough in our tanks at all times to make us through. But they were having driver shortages because of people being out with COVID. So what they did to be able to take care of us was they gave a $4,000 sign-on bonus and upped 40 hours more for their benefit of vacation time to get more drivers to come in. And they were able to, I mean, they rectified this situation in less than 3 weeks. So.
Wow.
So we never went without gas. So they took care of, I mean, there was a phone call to the president who gave us his cell phone number during the meetings and said, I will take care of it, promise. And
it's a straight buy for a period of time as opposed to some portion hedged or,
yeah.
You know, so whenever you bought it, whenever you put it out to bid, that's the locked price for a school year.
Yes, and I think we have one or two more years left on that. I think it was 3+ and renewable for 3 more. So unless something dramatically changes, we would probably let it roll, just keep that rolling until it ends.
That's the same locked in.
So the courier cars, they're probably stationed here?
At the warehouse. Okay. Oh, no, the couriers are here.
Well, it depends. We do have mail couriers that are here, and we have, you know, box trucks that are our warehouse.
Okay. So they would go one of these places to get gas? Then?
Yes.
Okay.
All district. They would go to the Royal Canal Street. There's one at maintenance.
They have one assigned, probably.
Yeah, they have one at maintenance. They would go there.
Okay.
On Canal Street.
Any questions on mine? Tulsi, it looks like she's thinking. Do you want to ask and see if they have any questions online?
Does anyone that's on Zoom have any questions for procurement?
Not right now, no. Thank you.
Thank you. Carl, I saw you talking, but you have your mute on.
All good.
Thank you.
Just thank you.
On the fuel buy, just using that as the example, have we ever explored the item of taking X percent, buying at a flat rate, and then hedging?
We have. So,
okay.
We did hedge 4 or 5 years ago. It really was not.
Didn't have the skill background
hedge.
To do it.
Yeah,
okay.
It didn't work out
well. No, so more used to that than I am the straight buy for a long period.
Yeah. We did attempt that for a little while, and it wasn't for a while. So the risk was not.
You didn't have the skill set to manage the risk.
Well, we had an outside consultant doing it for us, but it was not benefiting us to do it.
So. Any more questions, Mark?
Well, just so. Even things like, you know, sports uniforms and stuff, do you all do that also, district wide?
So typically, things like that would be a discount, percentage discount.
Okay.
Discount would be the same. So, I mean, and I think we can do that most of those.
Yeah.
So.
On something.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're gainfully employed is what you're telling me.
They've always had more to do.
Yeah.
There's nothing in the district they really don't touch.
Well,
when it comes to buying, I mean,
true.
The district.
Well,
individual schools may be a little different with needs, but the district.
How about like the boosters? If the boosters need, you know, say, a banner, you don't deal at all with the boosters.
No, boosters can piggyback off of their
yes,
contracts.
Absolutely, and we encourage
yeah.
them to use our bids and
right.
reference our bids.
Okay.
And, you know, to spend money like it's
right.
the district's money,
right.
or more so like it's their money, right?
Right. Not to spend it like it's district, but take advantage of the district.
Right.
Wish it was your money. Yeah.
Well, I noticed on Corkscrew Road at the start of the school year, there's brand new Estero High School signs. And they're beautiful. They really are. Compared to the crappy old sign that looks like somebody took a BB gun or paintball mm-hmm. guns to it. So that would probably go. Somebody probably bought that.
They probably use their internal fund or their funds.
The boosters are internal,
but
they probably
but they
did
use our PBAC
yeah.
or
okay.
our bid. Yeah,
okay.
I think we have a bid for that one.
Okay,
yeah.
Right.
For signs we do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And the schools, what they'll do is send their money in from their internal and stuff
sure.
in the district, and then work through their
right.
bids
okay.
to order the stuff.
Yes.
Right. So with the boosters, you don't necessarily the boosters use your contract, but you don't mess with the money part.
Yeah.
Right. They would send the money like
yeah, directly.
Yes.
Okay.
And like playgrounds, that's another good example that they would use their like PTO funds and things to purchase playgrounds.
Additional playgrounds.
Yeah, additional playgrounds, and they'd go the rest of them. And they would also go through safety and security and maintenance and all that, you know, the same that they would if they were using district funds.
Yeah, we make, for things like the signs and the playgrounds and stuff, they send the money to their budgets.
Okay.
And it's worked through their budget because there's more than just purchasing it that has to happen.
Sure.
You know,
yeah.
We, our safety department has to make sure that
right.
we're in the right spot, that it has the right fall service.
Correct.
It has all of this stuff
right.
as well. And you know, like the electric, then when they run to the sites, the electric, they have to make sure it follows all the rules. And so they send it here and it goes through a whole process that
okay.
needs to be done.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, for some odd reason, Estero won't allow electric signs, and that's really the bane of Estero High School. They're really not happy with that. So all the athletic stuff, and or something else. That's all I got. I appreciate it. Just trying to understand.
Yeah.
Thank you for giving us your time
Absolutely.
Today. I know we're a short committee, but
yeah.
we wanted to at least get a few questions answered. It's easier during the summer or the end of the summer when it's not as hectic.
Right, right. That's okay. We
can
made
have,
it work.
Can I have one more?
So just one.
Yeah.
Can't be a multi.
So I'm at the school and I want something, and you don't have a contract for it. Yeah, so then you go out and you decide as a team.
Depends on how much it costs.
Okay.
So if it's
okay.
up to, and Maury, you're going to have to help me with this, $10,000,
mm-hmm.
up to $10,000, we just tell them, get the best price that you can.
Okay.
Okay. Anything $10,000 and over, and I'm very proud because we just had our audit and there were no findings, so this was a big part of that.
Sure.
Anything up to $34,999.99, between that $10,000
okay.
and almost $35,000, the school has to get three quotes.
Mm-hmm.
So, and sometimes we'll have the bookkeepers or the school say, well, I got a quote from our awarded vendor, but then I got another quote from another vendor and they're lower and it's the same item. So I will take a look at that, and if I think that it is a significant savings, because I don't want to do any disjustice to our awarded vendor, but sometimes it's a significant enough savings that I'm like, we got to do this.
Right.
So I will make that call, and then I will have backup put into the system so that when we are audited and they say, why did you go off bid? Well, here's why. So,
how does that work with purchases through grants? That it's a much more convoluted situation.
Thank goodness grants is over, you know, like there, that they have to look at that, yes.
But they look at it from the perspective of, can you buy this with the grant? Is it okay within there? But then they would come to you for procuring the item.
Right, and we still ask them to use our bids for those items. Now, sometimes it depends on what it is. If we don't have a bid for it, then we just have to look at those on a case-by-case basis. It's very rare that.
Right.
So
continue with your numbers. Because over 35,000.
And then anything that is between 35,000 and 50,000, then procurement would get involved and help them do an informal solicitation. Anything over 50,000, we do a formal solicitation. And of course, it comes to the board.
Okay, So, the school wants to put up an electronic scoreboard. And it's like it's $130,000. The boosters have raised the money. Okay, it would seem to me you all would have to get involved in that too somehow.
Yes. Well,
okay.
We actually have a bid for that sign, so that's perfect.
Okay, so yeah. All right, so they can't, even though they've got their own money, if it's going on school property, there's all kinds of wickets.
Yes.
Correct.
Yes.
Yes.
Anything,
okay.
any structure of any way, any form that goes on a school district property has to go through that process
okay.
with maintenance and safety and,
right.
and procurement, and it goes through that. The purchase order itself or the requisition itself is set up so that it triggers who has to
yes.
see it based on
the category
item that it is.
Right.
So there's a category that's attached to it, and if it's a playground or anything like that that needs a safety thing, safety sees it.
Okay.
And then they approve it, it goes to maintenance to make sure that there's all the stuff is in a row for that. And usually the schools will have to provide like a schematic or whatever,
the plans
and all of that stuff before it makes it through the process completely.
All right, so the same thing then with warranties. You all were looking at warranties all the time too. How much in, is that in the system then? That we bought this scoreboard,
yes,
it's warranted for
that's
3 years.
Specs.
You know,
that's
at this point in time, then we've got to get another contract to do maintenance beyond that time.
Correct.
You know, sorry, Gwen, the idea that they did pass their audit with flying colors, that's something that ought to be in the board minutes. You know, and then we ought to, because people think we're not effectively managing the dollars.
Right.
So anytime you can get something like that, we need to be air writing that up in the sky, you know.
So I have to add something too. I'm sorry, but you know, I'm proud. I'm very, very proud of this. We have over half of our staff is brand new, and they have no procurement experience.
Wow.
Because, you know, procurement elsewhere makes decent money. So I'm very blessed to have the team that I have right now, and they have done an awesome job, and so have our you know, long-term employees with help training them and making sure that they're doing everything right, because procurement can be kind of complicated.
Yes.
And we've got a lot of process documents and checklists to make sure that we are following everything with the T. But when we got that audit back, and this is my first year as being a director, so I'm just a little over a year of being the director, so I was super, super proud of that.
Yeah.
What
is, I was going to say a question. It's going to come out wrong. Why is so much of the team new? Did they leave?
I've been with the district 26 years. I'm going to tell you, and up until 7 years ago, I was a Spalk employee. We don't pay like other entities pay. So case in point, we did have a person that left us to go somewhere that looked better. And money-wise, it was a lot better. Morale, right, was not as good, so they came back. But still, when you have other entities that, first of all, don't have as much work, and I'm not even, you know, as much work as our department does, because there's 11 of us. This time last year, there was only 6 of us on staff. So, and one of those, 2 of those couldn't write bids, couldn't do ITNs. Basically, they were there to support the agents that could do that stuff. But when you're paying this, and they could go across the street and make this, and we will pay for their children's insurance.
And that's what happened.
You know what I'm saying? So that is exactly what happened.
I've been trying to turn for 7-8 years paying for your kids.
One went to the city, one went to the county, one... And I'll be honest, what I think happened, and I know we're on record and I don't care, but I think what happened is, you remember when they posted everybody's salary on Facebook?
Mm-hmm.
Those people got a hold of that and they were like, they couldn't believe it. So they were
Because at that time, some of the market rates had happened.
I know, that was so sad.
You know what I'm saying? And so people like me that have been in the district for 26 years, if I was still on Spalk and you just raised everybody up to $15, you're bringing these people in the door that started 2 years after me and making 10 cents less an hour than I am. That's hurtful to your senior employees. So, and yeah,
anyway, we've got way off the topic there.
Good job, John.
No, I mean, it's,
you shouldn't ask me my opinions.
No, I mean, it is a question because it's, you have to compete for resources.
Absolutely.
That is a pure commercial resource. Mm-hmm. I said it's going to come out wrong. A teacher, per se, is not a commercial resource. People like procurement person or bus driver is somebody who has afforded multiple different options.
Yeah.
And I think that just resonates with why there are bigger issues with retention that need to be better understood in a place sort of northwest of here. For conversation. Yeah.
Well, it sounds like they're the training place for the area. They bring them in and train them.
And that's what happened
with the buses. I lost
2 really, really, I mean, I was in the process of grooming, you know, one of the ladies that I lost that went to the city, and she's amazing, and I'm sure she's doing amazing things there, but, you know, I couldn't, you can't fault anybody for wanting to better themselves.
But see, part of that to me, too, is back to your question, too, about local control. Because our area, we know the competitors locally, and if we had the ability to deal with that local, that may not be happening in this county over here, or this county over here, because we have a different economic structure.
Right.
So, but if we had that ability to say, well, you know, we do need to do this because we're having a brain drain. So,
and we have a question.
Yeah, we have a question from Chelsea.
But I just want to remind us too that you know, it's very frustrating to hear all the time how the county pays and what they pay and stuff. I want to remind everyone that they get their money differently than they do. They have full control over the amount of dollars that they get. They can go out, they can raise their millages, they can do that stuff. We have no control over our dollars, right? We are told what we're getting, and we must live within those dollars. So there is a total difference in what other people are able to do and what we're able to do, and it's very frustrating because we all want to pay people way more.
Yeah, we don't have revenue. The city has revenue.
Who sets the local school board millage rate in excess of rollback, or makes that decision if it's going to be, you know, whether it's going to be
The legislative process is the one that determines that, and then when the FEFP comes out, they tell us what our rates are what we're going to go with.
So it's at the state level, and then that is communicated down to the local county, that this is what your millage rate is going to be based on your tax roll this year. It's going to be an excess of rollback. It's going to be at the former rate, et cetera.
Yeah, that is correct. And we're capped, so even if... So the FEFP makes sure there's equalized funding with all school districts. So it's really a matter of how much the state puts in versus how much local puts in. But you're capped at that amount no matter what it is. And I want to tell you, we have not had one student count yet, right? We received our second
calculation.
Yeah, we're in our second calculation. I already have a proration of over $1 million. Not one student count was taken, which tells me the state already cannot fund what they've said they're going to fund, which means I'm going to see more prorations coming down. So not only where the county has their millage rate set, they're going to keep getting their money. We're not even getting the money they promised us we were going to get if our students were all here. So we get these double whammies all the way around. Now, the state last year did us really good. They put in an additional allocation in case they couldn't fund it. That was really good. So any proration I got my money back. They didn't put that in the budget this year. So this year we're going to see prorations all year because there's no way they're going to be able to fund the growth that Florida is seeing. They're just not going to do it. So the question we have from Chelsea is, which expenditures require board approval? The type and dollar amount, definitions, and thresholds.
All expenditures that are over $50,000, that's in a year. So if we anticipate spending $50,000 for a service or product in a 12-month period, that has to go to the board for approval. So typically we would just take, you know, an agenda, we would try to, procurement does not give those amounts. So that would be up to the departments. They're the experts of that. So they would be the ones to get us those expenditures.
However, procurement does monitor it.
Yes.
So if they say the expenditure is going to be $60,000 and that's what we take to the board, once they hit that $60,000, nothing else can be purchased until they go back to the board with an increase for it. So it's
correct.
Not like they just throw it out there and then it's just, you know, buy, buy, buy.
Right.
They do monitor their expenditures.
And
two follow-ups, sorry. It was just in the same line of thinking. I was just wondering how it all works. So I was looking at last year's budget packet, and I guess in one of the earlier meetings, we were handed a policy that was going to be adopted. It was entitled the Small Business Enterprise Program.
That's sweet.
And I was just wondering, you know, I know for amounts, it makes, the language it uses is for board contracts. So that's kind of what I was trying to figure out, to what falls under the definition of a board contract, and then how
So I really can't speak a whole lot right now about the business enterprise part, but what I can tell you is that rarely do we have an expenditure that's not going to be over $50,000. And what I mean by that is, and you're going to have to help me explain this because it's kind of complicated. What we do, every requisition that comes through, if there is not contract, or if we don't already have a board approval for that, we run a report in PeopleSoft to see how much we have spent. And once that we get close to going to $50,000, we reach out to the department and say, we're getting close. If you anticipate spending more money for this, we will need to take an agenda to the board. So, and like I said, that was one of the audit things that we had to pull. We had two. Mm-hmm. Two that were like that. So that's very, very rare and very, very odd. I hope that answers your question. And then, of course, for every requisition that we approve that does have an agenda associated, which most of them do, we reference that bid number on the purchase order, and we also track that in a spreadsheet. Believe it or not, for every requisition that we approve, we justify it some way, shape, or form. Either it was a piggyback bid, or it's instructional materials, or it's bid exempt, or it is on one of the school district's bids.
Yeah, so y'all correct me if I'm wrong, but mm-hmm. even, let's talk about supplies at schools, okay? So somebody's going to buy paper, it's under, $50,000 for sure. However, when you buy the paper for the whole district, you're going to be over $50,000. So there is a bid, so they have to use what's on the bid, even for small office supply items, for custodial items, any of those types of things. There's a bid out there that they have to use because that's within the best interest.
So they're a preferred vendor then, obviously, for things like that, so we are going through Staples, for instance.
Yes, absolutely.
We're going through this. That makes sense.
Staples is a feedback that we have.
Someone's assessing that ahead of time for cost. Mm-hmm. There's obviously huge budgetary constraints and concerns.
Yes.
My point of just bringing up that small business enterprise program, I imagine then, although it references board contracts, it really, there's not much you can do because with certain things like supplies, you're pulling for whatever you're going to get the best cost advantage on because a pencil's a pencil, and they're big corporations. But mm-hmm. with this, I imagine related to construction, capital projects, things of that nature, and then that is being done on the board level. This is part of the board, or is this internally, this policy is being implemented?
So, first of all, I don't think it's a policy yet. It's a proposal, if I'm not mistaken. So they brought the proposal to you all as we are working through it to see if there were any suggestions or anything that we had not thought of. So it's not yet become a policy. It is just that was a draft of what we're working on, and I think Ms. Giddens had something else.
And I will say on that, the drivers of that process were, it's okay, they don't need to say that. The drivers of that process, if I'm correct, were a couple of our attorneys that are no longer with us, and so I made a note to find out where we're at on that, but with the shifting and changing of our attorney staff, I don't know that a lot has been done to move forward on that at this point. It was presented to us as a potential process, to use, but I will ask the attorney where we're at.
I would like to just add real quickly one more thing. September the 27th, procurement and operations teaming up to do a vendor open house. It's going to be down in the Caloosahatchee Room. Anybody is welcome to attend. It's free. We're going to have some of our big construction contractors present so that they can talk to small subcontractors and explain to them how they can do business with the district and how they can work through a general contractor to get.
And don't you do that on a regular basis?
We do. We've had virtual, we've had in-person, so I think the last one that we did was a couple of years ago, because, having a lot of
here last year. So,
and what do you, what's the title of it?
Vendor Open House. And there is a, if you go to the procurement's website, they just put a information on there about that.
Anything in the newspaper too, right? I'm saying the newspaper, but
they're actually, they're doing a mass email to a lot of vendors. I'm not sure, operations is kind of leading the effort because they have more staff right now than to manage something like that. So I'm just going to be there as far as, like, I'll probably do some type of presentation.
I will ask Frederick, it's a good idea if we're doing this. Like, what is the communication out to the public that we're doing besides the mass emails and stuff? How are we communicating to other people that might not be on that email list so that they can be a part of it as well? So
yeah, what about staff, like teachers?
Yeah.
Like what?
Will teachers be included in that? Because you have teachers that are doing programs that, let's say they have 150 or 180 students, it might be beneficial for them to show up and answer questions. Maybe they can end up getting a decent deal with one of those vendors for something that they have a project on and basically piggyback with whatever the district pricing is.
I mean, of course, anybody is welcome to attend.
It just makes sense with them being able to save a buck.
It's
why.
Yeah. It's typically geared towards just getting, you know, the group together, explaining, you know, that if you wanted to be a plumber, if you want to be the plumber for when we build a new school, this is the process. They think that they would come through procurement. They don't come through procurement. They would go through the general contractor and things like that. So, but yeah, anybody is welcome to attend. And we have talked about in the past having, I'm not really sure where we never really got anywhere with this, but students like shadowing big construction firms, and then we started talking about what's the liability, what if they get hurt, what if this, what if that, and it just kind of got.
I like the idea of it going around to the schools, especially I know what, let's just, that was one program I could think of off the top of my head, a STEM program at a school.
Mm-hmm.
You have science, engineering. You have all these technology different.
Now.
You have all these different components, and the STEM team could show up with their, you know, need list and at least start pricing it out. Because a lot of times they hit the parents up. Justin just got hit for a pretty nice penny. I think it was $1,400. But you know, if they're doing that type for their students, why wouldn't this be an option for them to try to make just a connection, even if the district wasn't going to procurement did step in, if the you know they could make the connection on it. May not be a bad idea. That's all.
Okay.
And it's just an email. I mean, you may not get a single teacher. You may get six. I'm not saying you're going to get 50 or 60, but
right,
you may get five or six that show up from
right,
what 115 or 116 buildings now. You could get that, and it may make a big difference to that those staff members and also to the family.
Well, what if, I'm processing your idea with students, and if anything, like if you have an entrepreneur program, that it should be included, you know, this is all that goes into being a vendor and having a business. So the information that you get definitely would be beneficial, I think, to
students. For that, where's the career day that we had when we were kids?
Exactly.
You know, or you could actually follow somebody, tag along a professional, say, yeah, I'll take one or two kids for a day, or, you know, split it up amongst two, 3 days,
but
and let them follow
that,
on.
The summer program, SOS, I never figure out what the OMS is, but anyway, the SOS program, they have at Dunbar Community School, and that's exactly what they do. The students take classes in the morning at the school, then they go out to businesses, and it's a partnership in that the businesses will pay them, I think it's $10 an hour or something like that, a certain amount per day. So the business partners will say, I will take, you know, two students for this period of time, or I will pay for transportation for this number of students, or something like that. And very, very successful.
We need more public-private partnerships.
Yes,
we do, and that's a very...
And not just selling the name of the field.
Yeah.
That was a disaster with...
But I think my statement about it is that, you know, coming from teaching, kids think, I'm just going to open a business. I'm just going to do business. And people will come, and I will make money. And they don't see all of the stuff that's in between.
But why don't we bring in some of the students that just graduated, that tried, or that have? Bring back some of the people for your program.
And I love your idea. I just think this is the wrong meeting for that.
We're getting off the topic that I went with, but offer her program. Oh, I know about 6 students that graduated last year that you could feasibly bring back. You know, a couple of them actually succeeded. And I know a few of them that failed miserably, and actually 2 at my house last night.
I'll give you my husband's card, and they can reach out to my husband. He's always looking to hire somebody.
See the former chair. Before me.
What is one thing I always like to ask parents when you have the stage, so to speak? What is one thing that you wish that everyone knew about your
Take care.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And, you know, we just come in, we work hard, we I'm real big on integrity and explaining and showing them what that looks like. It's all about how you act even when no one's watching. And, you know, you just do the right thing and everything should fall in place, right?
You would hope.
It certainly doesn't stop the work from coming, but we'll get it done. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's one thing that I think that people
should know.
Would you like to add? Or maybe Donna can say
something. She's shy. I have something for them. So they proved, especially this past summer, they get the job done no matter what. And again, like they were down in Lori and Tracy spent hours, and I know Lori. God bless her. I was sending her things late at night, and she's responding and getting things done. So, you know,
they had six, and two couldn't even work. Couldn't really do it. 2 were assisting, which means they had 4 people really working for, you say, 11 or 12 normal?
11, yeah.
So that's...
I'm still down 1, so we are supposed to be 12.
Yeah.
Yeah,
if you have 11 now, you were working with 2/3 less.
Right. And one thing I would like everybody to know, thank you for that, Kelly, and that is true. I mean, I could not be more proud of this woman sitting beside of me for her being my right hand, and I mean that. I like to think about, you know, who am I at risk if I lose, and she is top of that list. So that's, you know, that's one thing. And I think I just want to try.
She has switches for you.
Barb, if you need another job.
Yeah, she does. Yes, absolutely. Lots of
October?
Yes.
I know.
You are not allowed to
I'm
talk.
I'm devastated. And because she's taking drops, she's not even, she's like, I'll come back and volunteer. I said, no, you won't. You'll lose your retirement.
Yes.
Now that's
what do you have to stay
at?
1 or 2 years?
Third party contract.
You have to stay at what, 2 years?
Even that.
1 year.
And you can't
volunteer.
Is that true?
Oh, yeah. I heard
that. But
no, it's very true. And
we have cannot volunteer. You cannot do.
You can't go in and read to the kids.
Jeopardize your
retirement.
She's going to be downtown Fort Myers on First Street for a year.
I'm going to start saying my mantra is going to be take it to Tallahassee. Okay.
That is a problem, though. I mean, I understand the reasoning.
Oh, I don't.
But it hurts. It hurts.
I don't understand. Especially
we can't replace the people is the problem.
Of a shortage. Just think if she could.
No.
She's like 2 weeks of giving my notice.
But I mean, if Barb wanted to stay around and say, you out, and maybe we're in between hiring the next person.
Yeah.
Why can't we do that?
Is that statute?
Oh, statute? Yeah, it's statute.
Yeah, that's statute.
They will take your
retirement. Teachers have a shorter time frame because of the shortage. They shorten the teacher time frame, which any other staff.
But it's still there.
And I would not jeopardize anyone's retirement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
I told her, I'll come back.
And she's like, I'll volunteer. I'm like,
I'll
volunteer doing
it.
No, not
set
foot, because I love you way too much.
So we'll see you on the 2024 year. Okay, let's wrap it up early. We're at 5:30 on the soft stop today. We're short-handed anyway. Thank you.
Thank
we appreciate
you
both of you for coming in. Just
thank
taking our questions.
Thank you guys.
I
enjoyed myself.
Oh.
So with that, our next meeting is September 21st at 4 p.m.
Yep.
Hopefully it's in this room again. Yes?
At that meeting, we need to vote on the August meeting.
Yes, we'll have to vote on that. We don't have enough people to do it,
so. Right, but I just want to make sure this.
Right. Yeah, we're going to have to vote on the minutes. We're going to vote on officers again. Do we have to go through the with the attorney all over again? Last year I was like, can I bring a bottle and fill it with beer? it was really good. Okay, so the next meeting will be September 21st at 4 p.m. And thank you everyone for coming.
You know what? And I'm not stopping everything, but bringing that up gave me an idea that maybe, unless it's by statute that we have to do it every year, maybe it could be arranged that that first meeting, all the new people come at 4, and everyone else can come, you know, if you...
Or 3:30.
Or something.
3:45.
You know,
I mean, it's such a short presentation.
I have to find out if it's a...
are we going
to
have any new people?
That we better.
Yes, we have half
yeah.
people.
We better.
Oh, we're going to have the same people.
Yeah, technically new. Yes, that is true.
Yeah.
Yes, and Chelsea, they did receive your application, so you are on that. I wanted to let you know for sure. So.
Okay, thank you.
Uh
huh. And
will they approve it before the meeting?
Anybody that knows anybody that is, you know, in your travels and your coworkers or whatever that may be interested, please reach out to them.
What about bringing back Sean Williams? I don't know if he's on any committees, and I haven't seen Sean around
anywhere.
I think
he's on something else.
Why can't we have people from other committees here, too? It's a problem. We're shorthanded to begin with.
Spend money committee with the half-cent sales tax at one point.
But he's on, maybe it's...
It would be nice, because I know there's a few people that... I know Paul Cohen would have probably stuck around, plus been on the other committee as well. I would have done another committee plus this.
We went
but they made it tough on us.
About that, and I think it was decided not to double dip.
There's only like one or two committees that have a ton.
Yeah, but when you think about sunshine, if something that's talked about in one committee, it could influence something on another committee. So, anyway, that's just my thought. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Got it.
It's over there. I'm like, what are you doing up there?
Yeah.
Yeah.